Thanks very much, Gerald, and massive thanks again to Edelman for all the beer and the wine and the nibbles. But biggest thanks will go to our two guests tonight. We've got Sarah Marshall here from the Wall Street Journal, and we've also, and obviously Sarah, as you can see, is 2 weeks away from giving birth, so this is above and beyond, really. And although Martin Bingham here at The Guardian isn't about to give birth, it's also incredibly generous of him to give up his time and come along for us tonight. Neither of them are being paid, it's out of their goodwill, so let's take full advantage of their goodwill tonight and send lots of questions at them.
So the reason we laid on tonight, some of you may have come along to the investigative journalism event we held, I think it would have been November last year, which was our sort of first IBP futures venture in a while. And we decided that we'd lay one on kind of digital engagement and audience development and social stuff. And it was they all sound like slightly jargony terms sometimes. They're flung around a lot. But the premise for this was that as business journalists, which most of us in the room either are or will be or work in that sector, a lot of us work with paywalls and subscriber content. So we're probably all savvy enough to tweet out our stories and do maybe the occasional YouTube video or something. The odd storyfy here and there, but that sometimes is where it ends, and often we end up sending this stuff to our web editors to do all the hard labor on. I don't know how many of those trade magazine journalists here tonight, their magazines actually have a social media strategy or not. I know ours doesn't. It will have soon, but it doesn't now. Basically, Martin and Sarah here are massive experts in their field and going to be able to give us a few reasons as to why perhaps we should have. And I think we'll probably focus to start with on, it's a horrible phrase, but why journalists should, as a sort of personal brand, be doing more in terms of social promotion, even if they've got paywalls and subscribers. And then we might move on a little bit larger to what our titles could and should be learning from larger business titles and from the consumer sector, from broadsheets. So first up, we've got Sarah. If I just get this right, there we go. Oh, sorry, before we do that. Oh God, here we go. That's the very end. Right.
Are we done?
Brilliant. Yeah, all over to the pub. Right, okay, well, for now, you can see the second slide there. It looks great. The point is, hashtag IBP Futures. We want you guys tweeting about this, if only so I can do a said storyfy and sum this all up and share it with the people who haven't been able to make it tonight. So moving swiftly on, Sarah Marshall.
Thank you for inviting me, Nick. My role at the Wall Street Journal is audience development, that buzzword that you just mentioned. So if you don't know what audience development is, then it's kind of a job title that seemed to have emerged, I don't know, 2-3 years ago in a lot of newsrooms, which is really putting audiences first and putting the focus on the audience and really thinking about what you're trying to achieve overall and kind of working backwards. So by that I mean, for the Wall Street Journal, like a lot of you, we're a membership business or a subscription business, plus we also rely on advertising, so page views are important. So my role for the Wall Street Journal in Europe, Middle East and Africa is really growing our audiences, both the paying audience of subscribers and the audience's quality traffic and people coming and reading us online. And then previously to that, I was social media editor, so there's lots of kind of crossover. So, and then previous to that, which is kind of relevant, I think, to some of the things you do, I was at a place called journalism.co.uk, which some of you will have heard of. And the interesting thing about being at journalism.co.uk, it gave me the opportunity of working with a much more defined audience than perhaps working for a big global publisher allows. It was working with kind of a community of journalists. So our readers were journalists, and we kind of really got to know our audience very well. And you know, our business model there was kind of, you know, like a lot for you, I was talking to the editor of Construction News earlier about really getting to know your audiences and selling them things they need. So for journalism Amazon.co.uk, that was job ads, and it was conferences, and it was events and training and things like that. So I kind of come from that background. It's nice that City University is involved in this event. I'm a City University alumni. I was there 10 years ago and did the broadcast course, and then went into radio immediately and did my time kind of reporting, reading the news on local radio, and then kind of the shoe leather journalism of working at local print newspapers. So I've kind of done a bit of everything in my background. And I was going to tell you, even though it's not hugely transferable in some ways, or doesn't appear to be at first glance, but something that I've been working on recently with the Wall Street Journal, because I think there are lessons for us all, and Nick asked me to talk about formats and thinking about the kind of ways that audiences or our readers want to read online. So January the 6th we launched on Snapchat Discover at the Wall Street Journal, just in the US, so you can't see it on Discover in the UK. So for those of you who aren't that familiar with Snapchat, there's 100 million daily active users, so Snapchat tells us, and 8 or 9 billion videos watched a day. It's kind of the numbers are huge for Snapchat. And there's this kind of little section of it, which is where publishers partner with Snapchat, so we did a partnership with them. And why did we go onto Snapchat? We did it for two reasons, for essentially new audiences, and that's kind of where my audience role comes in, and revenue, because it's got advertising. But what's been really interesting about working on the Snapchat platform is I've been essentially kind of editing stories from London, partially because of the time zone. So we publish at 7 o'clock East Coast time in the US. So I produce two stories overnight, the kind of two stories that are kind of most Snapchatty, but they're business stories. And I think people were surprised that the first US newspaper to go onto Snapchat was the Wall Street Journal. It might be a less obvious choice than some other news publishers, but I think it's been a fascinating process for us. And what I've really learned is kind of now something that we can take back into other forms of journalism. And it's really made me think about editing down. And it's done two things, really. It's really made me think about audiences. So we knew we were going after a new audience. This wasn't necessarily a Wall Street Journal existing audience. These were younger audiences. I think 60% of the Snapchat audience is 18 to 34. So it's young. And then there's this group of 18 to 34-year-olds, which are probably considered old in Snapchat years. But in terms of Wall Street Journal years, they're young. So we were thinking a lot about writing for this audience. And what was nice about the planning process is we were able to take a step back and really think about audiences rather than just do what we've always done. And we were thinking about, okay, so who are the people who are going to be reading us on Snapchat? And we kept coming back to these three words. We knew that they were kind of future Wall Street. The people we wanted were future Wall Street Journal audiences. So Wall Street Journal audiences would be ambitious business types. I know a lot of you work for business publications. And we kept coming back to three words, which kind of helped us guide our editorial as we were planning, which was aspirational, inspirational, and entrepreneurial. So we were doing lots of stories about, a 19-year-old venture capitalist, or Jack Dorsey, or one of the kind of well-known entrepreneurs. And it really helps when you have that luxury of planning before you launch to a new audience for something. But what it's also taught us is kind of, and things that I think are very transferable to all of us is really kind of being respectful of audiences' time. I mean, let's face it, the way people read on mobile, on web, is they kind of it's all, we all do it. We kind of want to take in as much as we can quickly and scan read, and writing for Snapchat, we use bold quite a lot too. I mean, this sounds really basic stuff, but using questions and answers to explain a story without being condescending, because we would never want to do that, but using questions or lots of subheadings and lots of bullet points and lots of charts and lots of different ways of breaking down a story that's not a 2,000-word leader or page one story for the Wall Street Journal. So what we're quite often doing is taking that in-depth business story. So this morning, one of the stories we did was Facebook earnings, and really taking what was a 2,000-word story in the paper or online and really condensing it down into kind of the key takeaways for people. So that's something that I've been thinking about a lot recently, and then how we can transfer those lessons back into other lessons for our web journalism. And there's probably segues nicely into Martin and what he's been doing in terms of new formats and thinking about, again, ways of telling stories in not in 2,000 words.
Thank you. Anyway, hi. So, so I've not got a very traditional background into journalism, actually. In the middle of the 90s, I was working in record shops and making little football fanzines. And then the internet happened, and I remember realising one day you could do view source in Netscape Navigator. And I was like, oh my God, I can make these pages. And sort of from there, I've gradually gone from having an kind of SEO and then product role at the BBC to then having a kind of information architecture role and a user experience role. And then I gradually realised that basically I needed to seize the means of production because I got tired of designing products that people would then put print-shaped articles into. And so I ended up moving into editorial. So people talk about like a full stack developer who can do everything from like the front end to server side. I'm like the full stack editorial because I've kind of progressed through all the different ways that you'd make a product. But the thing I think that has driven me for many years now is if you've ever seen the very earliest clips of television, so there's tiny bits of scratchy surviving footage from the 30s, they basically had cameras and pointed them at people making radio shows because there was a microphone in the middle of the room and people stepped up to the microphone and said their thing and they stepped away. And the radio shows were basically based on variety performances. So it was a very theatrical thing. And to me, it seems like for most of the time on the internet, we've kind of pointed the internet at all the things we did already. So the video packages we do could be transmitted on television. The audio packages we do could have gone out on radio, and most articles could be printed out. And what I've been interested in, how do you tell stories for an audience that takes advantage of the two-way interactive nature of the internet? And how do you find those kind of native forms that are going to be the things that are obviously what you do on the internet? So it turns out that I keep trying to say just because we've always done it this way, let's try it differently. Sometimes it turns out we've always done it that way because that's the way that works, and I'm an idiot. But sometimes it doesn't. So we did a thing. We had a very successful story at AMT, which was a data journalism based site I was running at the Mirror, where Wayne Rooney's signed a new contract. It was on a ridiculous salary. And we just made it wasn't a full-blown interactive. It was literally a JavaScript ticker that counted up how much money he was earning on that gross reported salary in real time. So as you land on the page, by the time you got down, I mean, this number was just whizzing around. And you scrolled in a bit further and it said, and this is how much David Cameron has earned in this time. And that number didn't spin very fast at all. And then it said, and this is how much a nurse has earned in this time. And that number didn't move. And so then as the audience, you then sit there thinking, when is this thing going to turn over to one penny for the nurse? And I think that's a way that you could write an 800-word think piece about how dreadful it is that nurses are underpaid. But it's a very different way of telling that story and sharing that narrative to audience. So that's kind of been my drive, I guess, is to... I laugh about having the name New Formats because people always think it means games and JavaScript. But I honestly sometimes think New Formats means basically doing that thing, writing the story as 150 words that you know someone will read rather than 1,500 words that you can see in your analytics that the average dwell time on an article is telling you that nobody is reading this all the way through. I think, you know, when you're dealing with a subscription product or a more niche product, I think you've got a real advantage and you've got a real disadvantage. So one of the things I enjoy most of all now, actually, in terms of community and interaction on the internet is I belong to some closed fan groups for dreadfully old-fashioned 80s bands that I still love. And basically you've got like 600 people in there and they all love this one band. And you start talking about that band and people post pictures of the band. And then someone says, what team do you support? And you have this whole conversation about football. Or it turns out that a couple of people have hamsters and they start talking about hamsters. Or like someone says, my cat's died. And someone says, and you end up, you've built a little community around what your main interest is, but that almost becomes tangential to the community you've built. And I've always thought with B2B situations, you've kind of got that thing that you've got a group of people who have a common interest, but it's not probably the most dominating interest in their life. And you've got a real opportunity to build some kind of community between them and then learn from that community and get stories out of that community, which I mean that I basically keep shamelessly putting stories in The Guardian that I've gleaned from Facebook fan groups or the local parents group and stuff like that. I think social can be a very good news gathering tool. I think it can be a good way of selling stories. And I think, again, I tried, or I still try, very hard to drill into journalists a really big question. It maybe doesn't necessarily apply to B2B stuff in terms of the reach you're trying to get. But I always say to people, when you're pitching a piece, can you tell me who is going to share this article and why are they going to share it? And so I think the clearest example of this we had was when I was covering general election stuff for The Mirror. And so I had been out, I have to stress as a reporter, not as an active campaigner, but I'd been out campaigning with UKIP. And I knew that, the thing is that they have, many of their activists seem very lovely people, late 40s, early 50s men who are slightly dissatisfied with the way their life has turned out. But they're all lovely and very, very chatty and say the most astonishing things with no self-consciousness about the fact that you've just told them you're a journalist. But I knew that they had a hardcore support who genuinely, at the last election, genuinely believed UKIP were going to get 30 or 40 MPs. Now, it's entirely impossible under the British electoral system for them to have done that. I mean, there was just like no way. I mean, even the most outlandish prediction would say they would maybe get 5 or 6 at top. So I knew that in the morning, there were going to be furious UKIP activists. And we also knew that the SNP were going to do really well. So for AMPT, we did a piece, the reason I use it as an example is because it's shameless, but it also it demonstrates the point, is that we made a point, an article that was basically, this one chart shows you how the electoral system is biased against UKIP. And it showed the number of votes the SNP got, which was, I don't know, like 3 million or something, or 1.1 million, and they had 56 MPs, and UKIP had like 4.5 million votes, and they only had one MP. And we made the graph in advance, because nobody's going to actually measure how accurate it is. All you need to do is put, you knew roughly what the numbers were going to be, you just need to put the numbers on. And so basically the answer to the question is, who is going to share this? Angry UKIP voters. Why are they going to share it? Because they're really fucking angry on Friday morning. And so so that did great. I mean, it's and then about an hour later, we did essentially exactly the same article with a completely different tone aimed at Green Party supporters. And that sort of went, so lovely that you voted Green. You're like really caring, aren't you? That's wonderful. What a shame that blah, blah, blah. But it was a completely different tone, but it was basically the same graph with different colours saying you've got one MP, you've got this number of votes, the SNP with less votes have got more MPs. And again, Green Party supporters absolutely loved it. And as I say, that's shameless, and I did that in The Mirror. I suspect I wouldn't do that at The Guardian, but then that's an interesting thing about knowing your editorial tone. But that for me, that perfectly answered those questions. Who's going to share this and why they're going to share it? And then I think, certainly when at The Guardian, we think not so much about reach at all costs, but having responsible reach. So you want stories that do well, but you want stories that you're proud of doing and that reflect your journalistic values. And so I've kind of added a third part to that, which is why do you want them to share your version? So I think a good example of what we did with that was there was a story, it's a ridiculous story, about a giant rat being found. And it was just like the photo was forced perspective. So it makes the rat look like 15 feet tall and the guy looks tiny. I'm exaggerating for comic effect. And nobody laughed, so it obviously wasn't that funny. But anyway, so we reproduced the photo. And so instead of doing, everyone else seemed to be doing this massive rat has been found with no fact checking. And we did how to make your own massive rat photo. So you've covered the story, but you've covered it in an angle where you've kind of added to it. And we also did, I think one of the other things I would say that, or I've only been back at The Guardian 2.5 months, when the Panama Papers came out. So the big story has been worked on for months and months and months with really great explainers about it, but explainers that are at a very high level. And there's a subreddit on Reddit called Explain to Me Like I'm a 5-year-old. And someone had put can someone explain offshore banking to me like I'm a 5-year-old? And this guy in the comments like told a story about, it's basically like kids hiding their piggy banks from their mothers. And one of the guys is like, I'll hide your piggy bank for you. And so he's got a wardrobe full of piggy banks because his mum never looks in his wardrobe. And then one day she looks in the wardrobe and everyone's in trouble. But then it also goes on to say, but there were some good reasons why the kids were hiding the piggy bank. So that like one kid, his brother always nicks his pocket money. Another one is trying to save up you know, to buy a present in secret for their mum. And it kind of addressed something editorially that we hadn't quite, I felt, found the right angle on yet, which is why there are some legitimate reasons for offshore banking. And the example I always come back to, if you've been a translator for the British and US military in Afghanistan, you probably don't want people to know where your money's coming from. And so that's a really legitimate reason for having a murky audit trail of where you're getting paid from. And so we took that Reddit story and we did some illustrations, or that Reddit comment, we did some illustrations and put it up. And I saw some people giving it negative pushback, like basically, I can't believe The Guardian is just repackaging Reddit comments. But the thing was, it did something like 500,000 page impressions, and I don't believe 500,000 people go into that subreddit and hang around and read all the comment threads. And I think it did, as well as that, finding an angle into how to explain legitimate reasons for offshore banking. It also found, it was a really useful thing to the audience, because you yourself might say, oh, I understand offshore banking, it's fine. But your friend in the pub or the coffee shop might say, oh, blah, 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 blah. It gave the audience a tool to explain it to other people. And I thought that was a really interesting and useful social function of content. And I feel like I've been rambling for ages now. But anyway, so basically, yes, that's what I do. Not very profound and interesting journalism, but I look at other people's profound and interesting journalism and think, ah, but you could make this sell and be shared more in a social space if you present it in that different way. That's my thing. That's my elevator pitch for my thing, I've just realised.
Thanks for that. So just whilst we're talking about specifically, sorry, my voice is nearly gone. Whilst we're talking about the idea of actually making 500,000 page impressions from content that's potentially already out there, why should people in this room who do business journalism be wanting to do that? Why is that actually important?
So when I was working on Us Versus Them, and I was working with a really great guy, Rob, who was editor on the site, he once described it as like every time you have a successful game or jokey thing and you get millions of users, it's like grains of sand falling through your hands and you're hoping that some of them will stick to your hands. They'll be the people who follow you or like the Facebook page, and they're the people primed to share the next thing. And I think, I mean, in some ways, I kind of, you know, there are some B2B publications where you kind of feel there will be businesses who will literally just subscribe to the print edition forever, because they have always done, and nobody will ever get around to cancelling it. And so you've got a guaranteed revenue stream there, so that's great. But there are some businesses where that's, or some areas where that's not going to happen, and you need to think about how do you draw in and be useful to the, perhaps, I mean, I'm being a bit ageist here, but like the younger people coming into that sector, who maybe, you know, their media habits are very, very different. So you've got people who 20 years ago used to be regular newspaper buyers. It was very obvious that you would pick up your trade magazine. When I worked in record shops in the 90s, and Music Week was the thing. It arrived on Monday morning, it gave us the release schedules, it gave us the charts, it was the thing. It arrived on Monday morning and it told us what to do for the next couple of weeks in retail. If I worked in a record shop now, I can't imagine that I would pick up the printed version of it. I mean, I mean, I don't know, I might do, but I can't imagine that I would. And because I think if you look at any human being around you in an industrialized part of the world, basically any single second they can avoid contact with another human, they will be looking at their phone. And so if your content isn't on that phone, you're really going to struggle to reach that audience. People say it's a bad thing and people are addicted to their phones, but it's just, phones are interesting and distracting and they're full of content and they're full of games. And so you've got a real issue of how do you get stuff into that space where people are paying attention. I always remember the friend of mine who works at the Telegraph just on the road, Richard Moynihan, saying that when you publish your content into a social space, you want it to reach as many people as possible, and it's the most important thing you're thinking about. But actually, it's going to appear in between their friend announcing that their baby's just been born and planning a night out. And do you remember this old photo and stuff like that? It's like, why does your piece of content deserve to be there and get their attention? And so you've really got to think about the way you present it in that space.
You published a piece on Medium not that long ago. Yeah, sorry to hold you to this. But you said, I think it was along the lines of, how do you know, or five reasons or something, why you may have a fake news problem in your newsroom. I suspect that a lot of people in this room might have potentially the opposite problem. You produce a lot of worthy kind of stories, off diary stuff you've been working on a long time. You put it up online and it gets a quarter of the reads that maybe a slightly gossipy people story got or something like that. And you think, well, what was the point of the last 3 weeks of FOI investigations, all that stuff? Do you think that business journalists generally should be doing more, maybe venturing more towards what other people might claim is more clickbaity stuff? You know, is there a place for actually going, you know what, there's a lot of on diary things that we're covering that we could do in a more engaging way, and just go for hits, regardless of whether or not you've got a subscriber base with a paywall?
I feel that the word clickbait has become a shorthand for an article I did not like. And that the original meaning has kind of the original meaning of where you withheld the crucial detail. And I always think it's got an amazing history, because I will never forget walking out of BBC offices at Bush House and the Evening Standard billboard saying bombs on tube, and what they meant was the Madrid Metro. But that was how they sold that story to make you hand over money to the thing. And that's just a really, really, I think that's like an example of irresponsible clickbait journalism from 2004 or whenever it was in print format. I think you need to, as a journalist, to know why you're doing this story. Is it important for you as a brand? Is it important because you believe it's a story? Are you just doing it because you've always done it and nobody reads it? And then my question is, why are businesses still doing that? I was really taken by hearing one of the people who works for Firm Quartz saying that because they work on beats that are based around their interests, so, you know, this guy with his interest was like European economy and Bitcoin, he was basically saying, I don't have to file 200 words every day about the Brussels Stock Exchange because people expect it. And it's like, I mean, I that's maybe an interesting point to bring you back in, Sarah. There must be a lot of stuff that the Wall Street Journal does for hygiene, a bit like, I would say, it's on video, but we'll say The Guardian does horse racing and boxing because we cover sport, but I'm not sure that our coverage of horse racing and boxing are things that ever motivate people to buy the paper. You just have to kind of do them for hygiene. You must be in that situation, I thought, or perhaps free of it on Snapchat.
So we also have the Dow Jones Newswires, which is, an added... So stories will get produced, tons of earnings stories every day, for example, will get produced in the Dow Jones Newswires, and then we'll take some of them for WSJ.com. And yes, there will be a lot of stories that, are never going to be the ones that go as viral as your kind of, Reddit thread comments. But we kind of have to do them because we're serving our communities, and it's probably the same for you. We know what to expect, but I think where then the real value comes in, and I'm sure you all do this, is kind of the bits where you join the dots and you see the trends and the patterns, and those are the kind of analytical pieces that people really get value from, and if they're paying subscribers, they really do get the value from. So yes, there's a lot of stories that Quartz wouldn't touch, that a lot of other publications wouldn't touch, but they're on record. And I was reading something in, I think it was a New York Times article this week, and it was saying that, well, realistically, the story that made it big in Spotlight about the Boston priests and kind of scandal, that started as a nib, that started as a kind of, couple hundred word story at the bottom of page 23 of a paper or whatever. So, sometimes just because there's a background of these stories online, you kind of, you have to, I'm sure you're in a position where you have to cover them, and as the Wall Street Journal, yet we will always, I'm sure, be in a position where there will be stories that we're not just doing because we care about the page views. We know that some stories will get a lot more page views than others, not all stories are equal, but out of those stories, we can, we can do things that will make them much more appealing to the reader in terms of, putting a chart in or just breaking them down in a different way.
Question, Sarah, what kind of metrics should we, be looking at for kind of paywalled content? It's not just page views, what is it that you specifically look at to work out whether or not you're likely to get a new subscriber out of it?
So we look at all kinds of things, and I kind of go from one view to the next on what metrics are fascinating to us. I mean, I think for subscribers, if you know that you know, you see patterns in what subscribers are reading. It's kind of, you know, it's fascinating. I often think that the relationship between the time on a particular article and the number of words in it is interesting, because if it's a 3,000 word article, did you hold their attention versus a 300 word article? for subscribers as well, they behave very differently than non-subscribers to the Wall Street Journal. You know, they spend far longer on site. They'll read far more stories, which you probably all find. But it's that balance of kind of, you know, reaching new readers who are your grains of sand who you might catch and who might then, you know, get their credit cards out and dent their plastic, and we kind of are speaking for a consumer audience and a B2B audience in a sense, you know, an audience where it'll be their companies paying and an audience where it'll be them paying individually as subscribers. And that kind of, I guess, one of the things that we were talking about before in terms of social and subscription models. I mean, it's kind of probably a challenge for a lot of you here, thinking, okay, well, if stories are paywalled, how do you make them go viral in that way? And I think there's a lot of things you can do on social. And I think, what I think a lot of our journalists at the Journal have become great at is becoming known as the kind of news anchor for their particular beat. So, you know, you'll talk to somebody in the street and they'll say, oh yeah, I work for the Wall Street Journal, or, you know, talk to a friend and they'll say, oh yeah, I follow this journalist from the Wall Street Journal. A really good example, actually, who came, I don't know the full story, but he, John Ostrower, who was basically an aviation enthusiast, and he started blogging around planes and aviation, and I think RBI bought his blog eventually, and he's now one of our amazing aviation reporters. But, you know, he's got loads of followers on Twitter just because he's on other platforms, just because he's kind of become like so knowledgeable about the industry, and he didn't follow a traditional route into journalism at all. But you know, our oil reporters will become very well known for kind of, you know, being that social anchor around oil. Or markets reporters, we've kind of recently moved to a model where we have people we call markets maniacs, who are really kind of, you know, what it says on the tin, that, you know, they're really writing a lot of stories about markets and analytical pieces that audiences couldn't get from elsewhere. It's really kind of building up those followings, and it's really, you know, I always say to journalists, don't just push your own stories, don't just broadcast. It's about community, it's about talking to people, it's about, you know, if what you would see as a competitor has a story, then of course it's, you know, you're sharing, you're becoming the expert around oil or around construction or around whatever that is. And I'm sure a lot of you are doing this anyway, but I think that's kind of the key, is the smaller groups of communities that you can kind of engage with and really, you know, get back from and be part of those conversations with.
A sort of a question for both of you, probably Martin first. Talking about building communities, it's something that I know quite a few business sort of titles are trying to do at the moment. You know, how can you take people off Twitter, strand them on your website, get them commenting, but without all the lunatics? And you know, you've obviously got quite a lot of experience of all of that. What would be your kind of main tips for trying to build a happy community of ultra-engaged users?
So having a niche already, I mean, that's a massive, massive win. I think one of the things that I find interesting with community around The Guardian is that we have some really, really brilliant bits of community. So we have a thing called Readers Recommend, where basically on the Thursday, the community have picked a theme, and then they have a week to convince each other what the best songs are on that theme, and then they produce a collaborative playlist, and then the following week we publish the playlist and say what the new theme is. We've recently, the last two themes have been climate change and feminism, and I think the person running it is deliberately trying to troll the audience, but the fact that they've done those two themes and it's been really constructive conversations, those are things that it's quite hard to have constructive conversations about online. So we've got various bits around underneath the crosswords, but I always worry with general news. I kind of say that what motivates you to comment on a general news story? You're either angry about the news or you're angry about the way this particular outlet has reported the news, and neither of those things are particularly conducive to great conversations. So I feel like having that niche around an interest or, say I'm very interested in certain television programs, Doctor Who perhaps, But I think one of the things as well is you as a journalist, I think to pick up on something that Sarah was saying, that I worked at the BBC and then I took some time off and then I basically relentlessly wrote about how bad newspaper websites were, with just screenshots of this doesn't work for the user, blah, blah, blah. And so eventually one of them hired me to fix some stuff. And that's kind of, I think there's something about being, like choosing something that you're really interested in and then becoming a visible expert on it. And I say that's the thing part of my job is to distribute Guardian. I mean, part of my job is to distribute Guardian content onto social media, but I'm also not shy of tweeting other political correspondents who've got quicker to a story, other great bits of journalism. I was visiting with Hillsborough this week. I thought the Liverpool Echo did a couple of amazing things and point those things out. But also, I feel for me, it's like if there's an article about the future of news, I'll probably tweet about it. If there's a job going in one of the places that the people who follow me are likely to be interested in, I'll tweet about it. And you build that kind of personal, that personal niche. And I think that's something that you can do yourself to get very, very trusted in the sector, that's perhaps slightly divorced from your obligation as I'm running the official social media account of official publication, but that you can do, I think, is a really, really great and useful skill for you to have. It does sometimes come with a price. I mean, I'm not being funny, we did, part of the Web We Want series we just did, we did a stats analysis of the abuse that our authors got from commenters below the line, and I mean, of the top 10 most abused authors, 8 were women, and the two men, neither of them were white. And I kind of half joke and say, for a publication that regularly publishes like Jay Rayner and Jonathan Jones and Owen Jones and Simon Jenkins, for none of them to have made the top 10, I think suggests something really about the atmosphere there. And I think that's something that you very much need to take consideration of when you're thinking about putting yourself out there from a social media point of view. I've had death threats, I've had people telling me to kill myself, I've had people saying they hope my children would die. I've also got loads of great, great stories because people know me online and trust me and will contact me and say, I've got a thing, can I talk to you about it? And it's because I'm kind of I try and be very open and approachable, and I try and be very genuine and authentic to myself. So most of my Twitter feed is all about journalism, and then sometimes it's swearing about football, and then 12 o'clock at night, it's screenshots of Doctor Who and I'm drunk and I'm watching a DVD. But I always think that that's possibly career limiting in terms of ultimately being the Prime Minister, but I suspect I wasn't going to be the Prime Minister anyway, so it's probably, think realistically about how difficult is that going to be for you in the future.
There's loads of stuff I'd like to ask you both, but basically the reason everyone's here is probably because they want to ask you stuff. So just before I pass it back over to the audience, and I'm sure Gerald will hand around a microphone, as a sort of last one from me, what if you had to give kind of maybe not five, but some tips that, because a lot of people here will have limited resources, they don't necessarily have a big team who can do all of this stuff, Snapchat and things like that. How would you prioritize it? What would be the kind of the key things that they should take away and they could apply at their title and do themselves? And it would be important and useful. Sarah first.
Okay, the thing that has sprung into my mind immediately is probably is an experience from journalism.co.uk. And I might just give one point, because otherwise this is going to be, if I give 5 points at this length, you'll be here all evening. So we got to a point where at journalism.co.uk, we'd been writing about, how I said, some stories that we always do, etc. We'd been writing about, what's been going on in the newspaper industry and the news industry, and essentially, stories that the Media Guardian had and the Press Gazette had, so others, and Hold the Front Page had. And we're kind of always chasing the news tail. And I'd been there a little while, and then Leveson happened, the Leveson inquiry. And so there'd be there was two of us journalists based at journalism.co.uk, and always one of us would be watching the Leveson inquiry and basically writing a story on it, and always getting it out. You know, why would anybody come to us rather than the Media Guardian for it? And then the third, one of the journalists left, so we employed a freelancer to write about Leveson, and very few people were reading that story, let's face it, because people were going to the Media Guardian for that story. And so what it did, it made us all essentially go for a beer, the two of us that were left, and say, well, we've just paid a massive freelance bill for somebody to report on a story that nobody's really caring about or reading, or coming to us. We need to rethink. So what we did, we made a policy then and there in the pub that we were only going to report original news stories. We weren't going to try and compete with everybody. Why write a story that's already been online, quite frankly? This was the luxury of being at a small publication. And therefore, what we did, we said, we're only going to go after, you know, kind of original features and where we've got an original angle on it. And the very next day we started, and our story count went down from three of us writing kind of probably 8 or 9 articles between us a day and publishing them online, to probably each of us writing 2 articles, maybe 1 a day. But of course, page views went up. Story count went down, but page views went up, and the value to our audience went up because we were giving them something unique. So I would just my takeaway is to kind of, you know, think really sometimes you're in perhaps smaller publications where you have the luxury of being able to step back. And as Martin was talking about earlier, kind of, you know, challenge what you're writing about or challenge what you're thinking about and be different and write the analytical piece that other people aren't writing, because I think audiences get more value from it. And it was a huge lesson for me, and something we should have probably done, you know, 6 months earlier at journalism.co.uk, and it really kind of distinguished us there.
Awesome. Martin, same question but with a twist. If you had to same a question but with building a social media strategy from scratch at a small publication go?
But interestingly, I'm trying to build a social media strategy from scratch at a big publication. I think the thing is you just have to, at every point, ask yourself, why are we doing this? And so Facebook have introduced live video, and everyone's got very, very excited about it. And we've experimented with it, and it's been really, really interesting. I did a live stream from the International Journalism Festival in Perugia of Paul Mason. And we, as far as I can tell, had way more viewers than the official stream did, because at that point, Facebook was sending out alerts to everybody. So I was basically in the audience with my phone up in the air, bootlegging someone else's conference with a bigger audience. And you sit there and you think, wow, I mean, like, the ethics, the legal, the implications of it are massive. I've put it down there, but I could take my phone out and I could start live streaming this now to like 5 million people on the Guardian Facebook page, potentially. I don't think it would be the most popular stream we've ever done, but I could do it. And so there's a huge question around that. But the question is, why are you doing it? Because 10 weeks ago, I didn't have a live streaming strategy for the internet. So actually, at the minute, I can tell you why I'm doing it, because it's interesting and we think it's got some interesting journalistic possibilities. So we had David Conn outside the Hillsborough inquest on Tuesday do a live piece to camera. On Monday, it was World Penguin Day, and we sent some people down to London Zoo, and they went in the penguin enclosure with a zoo kit. They didn't break in, that would be crazy. They went in with a zookeeper who talked about penguins, and the penguins attacked the equipment, and then we remembered never do live television with animals. And so there were interesting things and to mess about with, but it's not my main thing. It's interesting. I think dividing things into why are you putting effort into this and what are you expecting back as the return, and measuring it. I was thinking, everything I try and do, I try and set what's the measure of success here. And again, genuinely, it can sometimes be a bit frivolous. So when I went back to The Guardian, I published an article, it was just coming up to Valentine's Day, and I published an article, and my measure of success was basically, can I remember how to use the CMS? I mean, like, I really didn't care about, like, thing. But also, I did it as a co-written thing with one of the new people on my team, and my measure of success was also, how am I getting this working relationship going with this person in the room? So I try and always think, what is the metric of success for a thing you're doing? And I think with something like The Guardian, you've got the big brand accounts that bring lots of traffic in on whatever social media channel they are, and that's great. And then I like the small accounts. So we've got a little gardening community on Facebook, which isn't huge, but is very, very engaged. And I like those things. I think a lot of people's social media strategy ends up in what I basically, because I've got one myself, the flabby middle of it's a Facebook page about your genre, and you haven't really got an engaged audience there, and you've built up a huge number of likes, but you're actually not getting much engagement or organic reach. And basically, you're not. It's like neither Arthur nor Martha. It's neither driving big traffic nor driving great community. And that's when I always want to step back and think, well, why are we doing this way, and what do we need to do differently? Did that answer the question? I don't know. I went off on one there.
I think so. Right. I've got a big sheet of paper just in case you're all shy, but I don't think you will be. Questions. Anna.
Hello, I'm Emma. I'm a digital editor at City. I'm one of those people that has about 50 questions, but I'm not going to be that colleague. I'm just going to ask one. We started off with two very separate teams, digital and print. We've merged the two together, and we're all one big, very happy fan. But, you know, we have a lot of situations where print is asking for one thing, print wants 2,000 words on a subject, I want one chart that shows X. How do you balance those two things? How do you say to a reporter who's got a massive list of stories, because, you know, we're a small team, how do you say to them, right, I want you to spend your time doing this?
Try.
So that's basically the $1 million question, isn't it? I've got to the point where I'm, been doing this for. In fact, I can genuinely start saying I've been doing this for decades. And so I've watched people merge print and digital, and then unmerge them, and then merge them back again, and then merge social out of that. I think a fascinating thing at the minute with The Guardian, with Facebook having such a big push on video, suddenly my team and the multimedia team are like, whoa, this is the thing, we need to work together. I think the thing is, you need to look at where your ROI on that stuff is. So, and I know that's a difficult message for digital people, because we have been for a long time. I count myself as a very digital person. I always used to laugh, if they put me in charge of the Guardian website, we'd be fine. If they put me in charge of the paper, it would not come out the next day, because I just basically, how do you organise a newspaper being printed? I've got no idea. So I've always been a digital person, and I genuinely feel that for a very long time, the digital people in the publishing industry have been treated like second-class citizens. They really, really have. And I think you'll see that very, very few digital people, when you get a kind of, oh, it's the time for people to get promoted up to the next level of management, it tends to be people with the print background who get up there. And I've just got a bitter chip on my shoulder about that, obviously. But I think that's the reality of things. I think what you need to do is, I think you need to think about, should you be looking at your resources having people who are really dedicated to the representation of stories for digital in a way of bringing them in? And I say, I'm not entirely clear on what your business model is. At the Guardian, we've gone through a few years of being very open, and we want massive, massive audience. Ad revenue appears to have all gone to Facebook instead of anybody who's got a website. So we've kind of had a reassessment of that. And so where I'm looking at things now is also interesting. Afterwards, we talked about analytics a bit. If you ask me very, very nicely, I might show you the Guardian's self-made analytics dashboard in real time of what we can see and what the metrics that are important to us. And one of the metrics we have is regulars. And we count regulars as people who visited the website at least once in a 7-day period for 8 consecutive weeks. And so we look very carefully when we do articles about what percentage of regulars have enjoyed this. So sometimes you can have something that's got not a huge amount of page impressions, but the audience has been 80% regulars, and you know that you've really served your core audience with that story. And then sometimes you will do something that's massive and you see that it's not got a huge amount of regulars and you think that's great because we have introduced the brand or reintroduced the brand to people who wouldn't have engaged with us otherwise. But I mean, I generally, it's boring, but I think you have to sit in a room and really think about what genuinely is our social media strategy, why are we doing these things? Having an automated feed with links going out on Twitter that you don't care about is fine because it might bring you a little bit of extra traffic, but that's not a strategy. And if you are going to do a strategy, you need to really, really think about how you do it and how it feels. Also, this sounds horribly commercial for someone with an editorial background, but I feel like I kind of want to stay in a job and I think we all need to get paid. And I think editorially, we have to be a bit more canny about that and a bit more willing to think about how the content we do isn't just about sitting in an ivory tower and saying, this is the content we want to do. We need to think about the content that our audience really wants. And the content that our audience really wants, that it's also possible for our publication to monetize. I've turned to the dark side, I can't believe it.
I think that's true, and I think that, I mean, that kind of long-winded thing I talked about at journalism.co.uk was because we were a team of six. Three people on editorial and three people on commercial, but we all kind of, you know, as part of my role, which was, you know, writing and editing, I was also, you know, organising a conference and bringing in money for training courses and things like that. So it was very much like, well, if we're going to pay £6,000 to a freelancer to cover, you know, somebody to sit there with headphones on and watch a video and like write down some points that somebody else has written online, then, you know, that's going to take me quite a long time actually to earn £6,000 by selling training courses. And so therefore it was actually through kind of personal experience and frustration that those decisions were made. You know, then moving to a huge news organisation, you kind of become a bit removed from that. But I think you're absolutely right. Digital people are much more efficient and close to both audiences, and knowing that story that, you know, used to sit on page 17 of the newspaper, you kind of thought that millions of people read. Well, actually, you know that probably nobody read it. So, very few people read it.
Yeah, so there's a view in our real-time analytics where you can look at the least viewed pages that you've published over the last 24 hours. It's not quite the naughty list, because I will always say that there are things on there that you don't expect to have been on there. So there's a classic example, someone I work with very closely, Lena Kreshi. She's a very, very talented young digital journalist, and she's madly keen on Harry Potter. And when, I can't remember, it was an anniversary was coming around, and she did this absolutely brilliant piece of finding people whose lives had genuinely been changed by Harry Potter. And so they were someone who had never really read a book until they got into Harry Potter. They were an autistic person who found real joy in the Harry Potter universe. A person who works at Potter. It was an amazing piece. And we did these little animated dividers so that, you know, there was like Hedwig and he blinks and the sorting hat, and it was great. And J.K. Rowling favorited the tweet of the link, but didn't retweet it. And I looked at that moment when she did it, bless her, I thought, fuck you. Because a retweet to her 7 million followers would, I believe, have made that our most read story of that day, instead of which it did about 12,000 page impressions. And I still think it was an amazing piece of journalistic work, and I'm proud of it. And at some point, I feel like we'll disaggregate it from the article and do the stories one by one, or there'll be a news, or I feel like it hasn't got, you know, it didn't go to waste, but it was that close to being the most read Guardian story of the day, and then was probably one of the least read. So, you know, it's kind of, but it's, again, that still to me is an editorial judgment. I thought it was a great story, it's a great bit of journalism, and also it spoke to our audience. We had a thing this week, I noticed on Monday night, you know, MPs voted against an amendment that would have taken in 3,000 unaccompanied refugee children. And I noticed that BuzzFeed did the thing on their UK News Facebook. They published on the Facebook post the list of MPs who had voted against it. And that to me was really interesting, because it's kind of quite aggressive and campaigny, but it's also a meme that goes around after these sort of things. My MP didn't vote for this. Here's the list of MPs. Email your MP and tell them you're disgusted. And I don't know that The Guardian would do that, because that feels a bit interventionist and campaigning. But so what we did the next morning is we did a call out to readers to say, what were your feelings about the vote? We do use Formstack, and so it all comes into us. It's not like you've got an open comment thread. And then what we got through was so raw and visceral about the feeling of like disappointment and a hypocrisy about, you know, talking about the Holocaust and the kind of work that Britain has previously done over kinder transport. And so we did a piece with the headline, "I'm Disgusted," which was a direct quote from one of the things. And I don't think a Guardian reporter would ever write a headline that started, "I'm Disgusted." You know, it's not a thing to do. But we had this collection of raw emotion from our readers about it. And that didn't do huge numbers. But about 60% or 65% of the referral traffic to it was from Facebook, because again, it perfectly hit that this is an article of quite raw expression of emotion that I can share, and because it says something about me and it says something about how I feel about this issue. And to me, that's something that you can't do with straight news reporting, but that kind of social community angle allows you again as a brand, you know, to express a feeling that you might write in an editorial in very restrained language, you might kind of imply reading between the lines in your news pieces, and you might get a really highfalutin 1,200 words opinion piece, but that the voice of your audience expressing the feelings of your audience that they can share, I think is a really, really powerful thing that we didn't have, I guess, eight years ago, so there's a thing you could do, that social mm-hmm. sharing thing.
I saw BuzzFeed, they did 26 reasons why you might want to hide in a disabled loo after Ken Livingston went into...
Today has been one of those extraordinary days in British politics that I can remember for a long time.
Hi, it's Gav Hollander from Construction EU. I should probably share the news for it.
Yeah, but we want to pick it up.
Okay, Gav Hollander from Construction EU. I'm not entirely forming this question, and I will caveat it with the understanding that the world has changed. But when we talk about writing for our communities, when we talk about building communities, when we talk about metrics we look at, back decades ago, the people would have had 8 million readers at its peak, News of the World 6 million. Journalists and the newspapers they wrote for set the agenda. My fear, and I don't know if this is, I'm interested in this shared really, is that everything we're talking about here is an acceptance that they don't, and that potentially, although there's many good things with that, is that the dodgy Catholic priests, the Nixons and the thalidomide peddlers might sometimes be able to get away with it in this world.
Are they getting away with it?
So, I don't know. So, yeah, they used, I mean, yeah, the summer won it or whatever, they used, you know, the newspapers maybe used to set the agenda, and now, you see these different communities forming online, whether around, you know, Trump or Corbyn or whatever, so there's like a very different kind of shared influence now, I think. But I actually, you know, I don't know, I think you only have to look at the stories of the last few years to think, you know, to compare them to something like thalidomide, you know, to look at the Panama Papers or to look at the investigations that have gone on around, you know, leaks or Lux leaks or whatever, then I actually think that investigative journalism is, you know, there's a lot going on, and...
I think the difference with leaks is someone wants it out there.
Mm-hmm.
It's someone else's agenda, though.
Right.
Do you see what I mean? Mm-hmm. There is a difference. Although it's very important and it's good that they come out,
yeah.
It feels like those big stories we're talking about are always a leak. It's not the time spent on someone really...
Martin's got something to say.
Yeah, I'm going to say I saw David Conn talk for 30 minutes this morning about the work he's done over the last 20 years in Hillsborough, and that wasn't a leak, and that is agenda setting. And I'm genuinely quite concerned about the business model for the whole of the future of journalism. But I sort of think there's probably enough rich people in the world who want to own newspapers and publishers for prestige, and that might be okay. I don't think there's ever been a better time to be a journalist. I really don't. I think one example that I really, really talk about, and I think does actually play to your point a little bit about other people setting the agenda, but I keep looking at Black Lives Matter, and I think police in the US have been killing young black men for years and years and years and years and years, and nobody did anything about it. And suddenly, the growth of social media activity in that demographic, in that country, meant that Black Lives Matter surfaced as a hashtag. And even you look at the kind of graffiti on Confederate monuments, is the kind of thing that if the local newspaper had decided to cover in print that a Confederate monument had been defaced and sent a photographer around to it, blah, 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 yep, then it wouldn't have made national or international news. But actually, you could spray paint that on a Confederate monument, take the picture yourself, and that is making a massive, massive step change, I think, in politics in the US. And I think that's a really, really important service that journalism has done, is to see that here's a story that we were underreporting, and that we were underreporting because of the diversity in our newsrooms, or the lack of diversity in our newsrooms, that we were underreporting because it just wasn't considered on the agenda. It still astonishes me that America did not used to keep a count of the number of people killed by the police across the country. I mean, really? Like, think of the amount of statistics you produce as a government, and that wasn't a statistic that used to be considered important. And so I think that's something where has been surfaced from a grassroots movement that then has been picked up and has shifted the agenda of the media and will actually shift the agenda of politics. And I think that's what journalism is there for, is to amplify the voices of people who need their stories heard. And I don't see any problem with that in the future. Funding it, I worry about. But the actual way that technology has changed the access to media, I think is a positive thing for us as reporters. I mean, really is a positive thing for... The junior doctor strike, you know, it turned out that I knew someone who shared a thing where their son had fallen over and cut his head open, and then there was this long discussion about should we take them to A&E or not because it's the strike day, and you were kind of looking at the picture thinking, mate, you really need to take that child to A&E, kind of thing. But I mean, that turned out because of the way it was, it didn't go in like, I've got a story here. But it's interesting that you could immediately say, if someone said, oh yeah, people weren't taking their kids to A&E and it's a sweeping generalisation, actually, I've got a thing that I could have anonymised as part of a story and use. And I think that was just a thing that we just didn't have access to before as reporters.
Hi, I'm Sophia from S&P Global Market Intelligence, formerly known as SNL Financial. I've got a more commercial question. Obviously, we're completely behind the paywall, but we have need to make some things for content free and share them. We can't do that with everything, obviously, because it undercuts the commercial model. My sales team will get very unhappy with me if I do that. Do you have any tips about how you should stagger sharing
of free content, or any tips about what you should make free, what you shouldn't make free,
how you should push it out,
so
that you're not getting on the wrong side of your commercial
team. Are you able to make those decisions about whether you free a story up or
not?
Yeah. I mean, I think it's a difficult one because I think as a consumer, sometimes you go to. You'll go and the FT will have done an FT sponsored list of best books to read this year or whatever, and you're just like, because there's huge value in that and I'm not going to subscribe because of that, that feels something like it could be a brand builder for them and free. It's always a balance. Look, we did a story with an exclusive on Lego last night, and we did kind of two stories. One was about the succession of the kind of billionaire owner of Lego, and then another one was about how they said that they should have supplied Ai Weiwei with Lego bricks, and then, you know, that's a paid story for us, and of course it was like the third most read on the BBC, and it was, I think, the Guardian picked, everybody picked the story up today, but, you know, probably most people read it on other platforms rather than the Wall Street Journal. But, you know, at the same time, you know, we, like you, have a pay model, and that story will have also, you know, appealed to, you know, to subscribers, and I think there's some stories that are just that either they're so big that you're competing, you know, something like Brussels, we would always, if everybody else has got that story and going big, then those are the kind of stories that we kind of put in front of the paywall for everybody. And, you know, certain things that are kind of brand builder stories, though, I think that's probably I don't make those decisions, and I don't want to kind of speak above my pay grade on making those decisions, but I think probably, speaking personally, not with my Wall Street Journal hat on, it's probably the stuff that everybody else has got, you might as well be part of the game, or the brand builder where you've got that, you know, that great story where, you know, it will do more for you getting your brand and your and new audiences and appealing to them and showing the sampling the content than you will get from the number of people who hit a paywall and then are converted.
Martin, you probably don't have that problem, so we'll probably just do another question. Yes.
Okay. Chat just there. Keep your hand up just so Gerald can see.
No, I can see. Don't worry, I've clocked him.
Lovely. Hello, my name is Sam Golden. I'm a technology strategist, and talking a bit more about making money out of it at the end of the day, which you have to do to keep going, unless there is enough rich people in the world to keep paying and losing money on media publications, which would be great. Obviously, you guys have pretty interesting models. So there's the Guardian's patronage model of people contributing great journalism, and you have a paywall. Are there any kind of alternative models, like micropayments and things like that, that you guys are looking into, and any that you actually see becoming more popular and maybe saving journalism?
I was on a podcast with Jonathan Haynes, who's our tech editor, and he answered this by basically saying, if I had the answer to this question, I would be the most valuable person in London, and I wouldn't be doing this podcast. And so, likewise, I mean, I think, you know, The Guardian has gone through an era where it essentially was saying we'll do reach at all costs, and reach will bring in enough digital ad revenue that will offset the print ad revenue that we're losing through everybody losing circulation, and that's clearly not a bet that has paid out. And so we are looking much more closely at the membership model. It's interesting actually, because I sometimes find I will write something that I think is clearly frivolous and tongue-in-cheek, and then all the comments underneath will be, I cannot believe you have published this article next to a thing saying please support our valuable journalism. And I like to feel that the church-state divide applies to me there too. And it's not my fault they put an advert and spend money on the paper next to my obviously frivolous thing. It's something that we're looking at very hard. I mean, I don't want to go over my pay grade, but I think, I mean, the story's quite clear. We're making very, very big cost savings. We're looking at different revenue streams, one which is around the Guardian Labs branded content proposition, and one which is around the membership proposition. What shape that membership proposition takes, I think it's an interesting thing, because I think it's a massive challenge. If you've got a huge important game-changing story, you don't want to only show it to your paid members, and if it's that big, you're only going to have it exclusively for 10 minutes anyway, because your rivals are going to have access behind your paywall and will just obviously wouldn't just cut and paste it like your amazing Lego exclusive that we apparently did. So you've got to think about that. If you've got great journalism, you want to get it. I mean, what's the reason that you went into journalism? Because you want to tell stories, because you think stories are really, really important. And you think it's how people understand the world around them and make decisions about the world around them. And so you don't want to put that in a position, if it's like general news journalism, where people are going to struggle to read it, or you're effectively giving it away anyway because other people are going to cover it. I mean, I think it's clearer for the Financial Times and the Wall Street Journal that there's a proposition where you're basically saying, we are giving you information that will enable you or your company to make money, and that's where the value is. It's a lot harder from a general news proposition to that. So then I think you have to look at the things that you can really own yourself as part of your brand, or something that's really about you. I've said too much.
Yeah, I do feel in a kind of fortunate position where we have information, and it's a lot of it is about speed of delivery and about giving subscribers, as you're probably experiencing as well, kind of access to stuff that they find incredibly valuable. I think in terms of micropayments and other forms, I actually feel like the thing we were talking about earlier about efficiency and really getting to know your audiences and selling them things directly, I think there's definitely something in that, particularly for publications like yourselves, which I think a lot of you are doing anyway. But Blendl, which I'm sure many of you are familiar with, came out of a Dutch startup. It was a technology journalist who started it. Started in Holland. Essentially, it's an app where you're paying for individual articles. And Alexander Klopping was speaking at Hacks Hackers, which is something that I kind of co-organise a couple of weeks ago. He's the founder, and he was saying, and it's really obvious. I mean, he was like, somebody said, "Oh, what are people paying for on Blendl?" They're paying either like 19 cents or 49 cents. News organisations can set their own rates, and he was just saying, people are not paying for news; they're paying for analysis, which is so obvious. It's so obvious. So, if news is kind of seen as something that is available for free, And I think, you know, in a sense, news has long been free since the birth of the radio or whatever. You know, you could, you know, in the morning when I used to go and buy my local paper from the train station, then that the person at the train station who was selling me the newspaper could have told me that news for free, but I wanted that product. I wanted to kind of go through it. And I think that's where online does product quite badly, because you're not buying this, you know, when you're buying The Guardian on a Saturday, you're buying this lovely product because you're getting Cook magazine, you're getting, you know, the magazine, and you know, what online is really bad at is giving you that kind of nice product that you have that relationship with. So it's incredibly complicated, and yes, I don't have the answer, sadly, but I don't know that the future is micropayments. I do think there is something in bundling and giving people different levels of different, it's not something that in any way I'm saying that the journalist considering, it's again way beyond my pay grade, but it's, you know, I think there is a lot of, you know, we essentially exist for a lot of smaller communities, and I think there could be very interesting things done for a lot of organisations where they are the place to go to for, you know, people who can really, you know, trade off that content or really learn something and get value from it.
Yeah, I think I was going to say one of the other things that we've been thinking about very carefully as well, it's kind of, what do you do with people when you see they're on a particular stage of their journey in the connection to your brand? And I think, you know, the FT has been very, very clever about this, from my understanding, where they kind of, they try and model, when they see someone take up a subscription, they kind of try and model what were they doing just before they took the subscription. And if you can model that user behavior, then you can spot other people doing similar stuff, and then maybe that's the point where you nudge them to subscription. And I think one of the things that we're looking at, we've got a little work stream for a few weeks looking at, if we see you as a fresh cookie that we've never seen before on the site, so effectively, I mean, it may be that you've cleared your cookies or you're using an incognito session or whatever, but we are treating you as potentially a person who has visited The Guardian for the very first time, probably asking them to stump up £49 isn't the right message you want, or perhaps even asking them to do an email sign up is too much at that first time. So if you see that, what do you do differently on the behaviour of your site to show off what you think is the breadth and strength of your brand, then that may be, you know, I mean, for me, I'm always, it's like, well, that's maybe not the related articles in that section. Maybe you're showing what's just on the homepage that day down the site. You know, there's various different things you could do. And I think that's really interesting, of trying to get into more of a digital product mindset of testing and learning and not being afraid to, I mean, to be honest, I feel like one of the greatest lessons I can pass on to anybody, and you'll look at me and say, this is weird, but I've got past the point of thinking, if I fuck something up, I've fucked something up, what's going to happen? It's kind of like, The Guardian's not going to cease to exist tomorrow because I published the wrong link on Twitter. And it's not going to cease to exist in 4 weeks' time because we tried an experiment where we popped email sign up after the first two sentences of an article, and all we proved is that people hated that. But at least we've now got some data that will stop anyone in the business again ever suggesting it, because you can say you've done it. I had a favourite thing we did at AMPT, we made interactive bingo, you know, for the budget. You know, people always publish a budget bingo card, and we made interactive bingo. So you would land on the page, it would generate a randomised unique bingo card for you, and you could press buttons on it when George Osborne said long-term economic plan. And when you'd completed a line, you could press a button, it would send a code to us which would tell us which things you'd pressed and what card you had. And we had a prize, which was a signed photo of George Osborne. I mean, who could want more than that? And so we announced it about 2 days before. Everyone, it's got so many tweets, everyone was so excited about it. On the day, nobody played it. Literally nobody played it. And the thing was, for probably the next year that I was at the Mirror, the phone would ring once a week and it would go, we're the MEN and it's the Manchester Derby at the weekend. Do you think you could make us one of your interactive bingo cards? No, we could not. Don't ever phone me again. But at least I had the data to prove that we had over-engineered a solution for a joke. So we thought it was going to be funny. It was a funny joke. But it turned out the joke is just doing the bingo card. The joke is just making the game. Nobody actually wants to play it. They all laughed at the joke, but nobody actually wants to play it. So I mean, I feel like that. I've just got to the point where I'm just kind of not fussed about things failing. And I think you have to be. I say that when at the Mirror we went through the phrase where we said we will try these things, and if they fail, it's fine. Probably the first one couldn't have failed. that's always a risk when a business moves into fail fast, and it's fine. It's like the first thing probably can't fail fast. But that's what I try and be. It's, you know, we've just launched a different way of trying to promote our food content on Facebook from The Guardian. And if it doesn't work, I would delete the page in 8 weeks' time. You know, I'm just not fussed about it. It's just like, why worry about it? You don't have to keep something running for 2 years if it's not working. Try it. It doesn't work, delete it.
I think. Yeah, the nod.
I think.
You think, yeah. I was going to say we've got time for one more question. We don't. Guys, can we give our fantastic speakers, Martin and Sarah, an enormous round of applause? So thanks so much.